The valley of the shadow of death represents the perils of life from which God protects his believers, his children. The Delphi historic trails and Monon High Bridge are now indelibly linked forever to the murder of two schoolgirls, Libby German and Abby Williams. Good evening, my dear friends, and welcome back. Thank you for tuning in to another episode, True Crime Jesus. On February 13th, 2017, 14-year-old Liberty German and 13-year-old Abigail Williams were abducted and subsequently murdered while walking on the nature trails at the Monon High Bridge in Delphi, Indiana. Liberty managed to record video and audio of their killer. Yet somehow, all of these years later, the unidentified suspect has managed to not be identified. Either Bridge Guy is a criminal mastermind, or he is the most elusive man on earth, or perhaps he's a little of both. We cannot consecrate. We cannot hallow this ground.
Not only myself, but several in the community, I consider this hallowed ground, so to say.
The Monon High Bridge is now considered by some in Delphi, Indiana, as hallowed ground. Hallow means to make holy. A ceremony is usually performed on the land set aside, usually for burials, to identify the space as holy, venerated, and/or sacred. On May 7th, 2017, Pastor Todd Ladd of the Delphi United Methodist Church organized a community trail walk to cast off evil and make the trails holy again. David McCain, also known as Flannel Shirt Guy, also helped organize this walk.
Not using them and be too afraid and so forth.
My friends, it was less than 3 months after the deaths of Libby and Abby that we witnessed the reinvention and promotion of the Monon High Bridge and Trails. The Monon High Bridge cannot be declared holy. Libby and Abby looked after and protected each other there. They were willing to make the most extreme and ultimate sacrifice to protect each other. That, in itself, is a greater act than any other could, now or ever, perform in ordaining the soil on which they died. In my last video, we looked at Pastor M. This week, we'll look at a couple other interesting members whose names have been brought up on Reddit and in various Facebook groups. These two men are Pastor C. and David McCain. In 2015, Pastor C. was named Director of Church Development. Pastor C. was responsible for building upon the twofold vision to revitalize existing congregations and to plant new faith communities. That mission is to build upon the process of the fruitful congregation's journey that sets in motion churches reaching their full potential of being vital and vibrant faith communities in their local setting. Less than 5 months after the murders of Libby and Abby, Pastor C moved on to greener pastures. On September 10th, 2017, Pastor C was named as the next lead pastor of Liberty United Methodist Church in Liberty, Kansas. Mission accomplished. While it is acknowledged the important and vital role that the Delphi United Methodist Church has played, specifically with offering comfort to both families and the community, it would be unfair to not examine some of the interesting and troubling connections with the DUMC and the Delphi murders. What is certain is that several individuals and entities have made tremendous gains and monetary profits as a result of the tragic event of February 13th, 2017. These would include DUMC and Indiana Landmarks, Heritage Heartland Incorporated, and Wabash and Erie Canal Association. Dave McCain has intimate knowledge of the Delphi Trail systems. The trails are the McCain's legacy. Dave was seen on the trails most days for months leading up to the murders. Dave lives walking distance to the trails at Monon High Bridge. Dave gave a conflicting timeline of his bridge guy sighting and also directed Derek German in the opposite direction of the bridge when he was searching for Libby. It is rumored that Dave has pressured landowners to sell their property for the improvement and benefit of the trail system. There was an attempt to purchase the old CBS building through the Deer Creek Township Association shortly before the murders. But that plan was rejected by the town council. It is well known that Ron Logan's land near the crime scene has vast potential for trail development. There is also the possibility of natural gas and oil development, as stated in this geologist's report. There are two improper land deals that can be tied directly back to the trails or to Dave McCain. During the Strasser administration, there was a questionable land deal that would benefit the trail system. Then, another improper land deal during Shane Evans' administration benefited Dave McCain personally. Mayor Shane Evans submitted the grant application written by David McCain to the Indiana Department of Natural Resources for the Monon High Bridge improvements and received a $1.2 million grant. That money was then funneled to McCain's Indiana Landmarks, Heritage Heartland Incorporated, and to the Wabash and Erie Canal Association. Here are pictures of the current state of the bridge. Even with thousands of people from around the world going there, they still haven't managed to make the bridge even remotely safe for tourists. So much for their improvements. When are they going to fix Monon High Bridge? What is the status of the improvements? Who do we hold accountable for this? In my last video, we explored some religious overtones that surround this case. In particular, I discussed the meaning behind the shack and its significance in the context of the Delphi murders. The movie The Shack opened on March 3rd, 2017, less than 3 weeks after the murders of Abby and Libby. Delphi United Methodist Church held a screening of the movie. In fact, United Methodist clergy told its members that the shack can be a powerful metaphor for understanding God's desire to offer us healing in times of trial, doubt, and unspeakable suffering. The church keeps us grounded, flushing out the burden of life by providing a bedrock of faith and answers to humanity's deepest needs. In times of personal or national tragedy, such as 9/11, people flock to churches in droves. Donations increase greatly. There is something about churches that society finds in times of tragedy and hardship. Thousands of people all over the world have spent countless hours trying to spread awareness about the case. $325,000 has been raised for the reward fund, yet there has still been nothing. There has been so much mystery surrounding the Delphi murders case. Many YouTube channels, including this one, have covered dozens of different theories and persons of interest. There's so much online speculation, rumors, and digital enhancements. More recently, there have also been multiple unverified information leaks that seem to contradict the little information that we have been provided by law enforcement. Where do we go from here? It's impossible to tell what's real and what's not anymore. Now I would like to discuss what we know and what we think we know, and why it's so important that we differentiate between the two. What do we know? Well, we know what we've been told by law enforcement, which isn't a whole hell of a lot. For the most part, we pretty much just have the Bridge Guy video. The Bridge Guy audio of four words. We have a possible vehicle that may or may not have been parked at the abandoned CPS building near the crime scene. We have two vastly different composite sketches, and the difference between these two sketches is not even close to subtle. In fact, they are so vastly different that it is almost insulting to suggest that they are depicting the same person. If anything, the sketches only serve to ruin the public's ability to help identify the killer based on a resemblance to the sketch. Seeing as if you were to consider both, it could be basically depicting every male in Delphi. Keeping both sketches without context has all but destroyed the public's ability to help identify the killer using this method. For the most part, that is all that we know. It's been over 4 years since the murders. What we have been given isn't enough for the public to be able to help. Since the 2019 press conference, there have been copious videos, blogs, podcasts, Facebook groups, Reddit posts, and television shows, all claiming to have new insight or some form of new information. When someone hears about this case and logs online to look into it deeper, they are bombarded with a literal tsunami of information, the vast majority of which is contradictory to the information they will read moments later. In other words, when someone new tries to look into this case, it's almost certain that the information they will find is inaccurate, which deeply saddens me. The internet has proven in the past to be extremely helpful with unsolved cases when they have proper facts to go off of. We need a direct, clear statement by law enforcement giving context to what they are asking of the public. We need specific, non-contradictory information that clearly spells out what the public should be looking for. Any information given to the public, no matter how insignificant, could change everything. Don't underestimate all of us. We are a resource that should be taken seriously and used before a bridge guy kills someone else. That's all the time we have for this episode, my dear friends. If you enjoyed this video, hit the like button. Subscribe to this channel if you haven't already. Also, I'd like to give a shout out to my friend, Blue Angel, who helped me greatly with this video. Ben & Jerry's has recently released some new ice cream flavors in Canada. These are Coffee Coffee Buzz Buzz, Oh Conada, Cookies a la Caramel, and some more please. Our friends at Ben & Jerry's have also released a new dog ice cream. Ponch's Mix is a delicious frozen peanut butter and pretzel blend. Your favorite four-legged friend will also enjoy Rosie's Batch, which is a frozen dog treat with pumpkin and mini cookies. So until next time, my dear friends, this is True Crime Jesus, signing off.